Professor Andres, when and why you decided to study medicine?
Before to answer your question, I would like to thank you, Dr. Fogazzi, for the times and the interest in my recollection, and Dr. Soletz and Professor Cameron, and the International Society of Nephrology. Well, I decided to study medicine like almost all young people at the end of the Lyceum. And the reason why I studied medicine are not very clear to me. I think I was the only real choice. I had some interest in marine biology because my grandfather, Angelo Andres, was a marine biologist who, with Dorn, founded the Marine Biology Institute in Naples, and then was professor in Pavia after Golgi for many years. And so there was a certain interest in our house, all these books which came to my father. And so perhaps this was the reason.
While studying medicine in Torino, you were an intern in the Institute of Anatomy of Giuseppe Levi. This institute, some years before, had been also frequented by Rita Levi Montalcini, Salvatore Luria, and Renato Dulbecco, who, in later years, became Nobel Prize laureates. What are your recollections of that institute?
Well, really, it's not some years ago. I think they were there when I was a student, because I enrolled in the Faculty of Medicine in 1942, during the war. And at that time, Professor Levi, because the racial law in Italy were in 1938, he was not in Torino, he was in Liegi, because he was obliged to leave his chair and to leave Italy. And so in Torino, when I enrolled in the medical school, in the Institute of Anatomy, there was only, I remember only, Professor Amprino and Filogamo. And Professor Levi was, the influence of Professor Levi was there in everything, but he was not present. And then in 43, there was the German invasion, and because I was born in 1924, I was obliged the class of 24 was supposed to be recruited by the Repubblica Sociale, by the neo-fascist Republic. So I went on hiding, and I didn't attend the medical school for 2 years. It was only after the end of the war, in April 45, that I was able to continue my work of intern in the Institute of Anatomy. At that time, Professor Levi was back, and there was Rita Levi-Montalcini, Dulbecco, Amprino, and Filogamo, my direct supervisor, Professor Amprino. But I have a perfect recollection of Rita and Montalcini, who was working with the thermostat, and the electric power frequently was missing, so she was running around because she was taking care of the tissue culture of Professor Levi. So I have a clear recollection of Rita, and I met again in Rome, and we went around giving some lecture together for several months the early 60s. So the Institute of Professor Levi there was this atmosphere which is beautifully described in Prize of Imperfection, this book, a beautiful book of Rita Levi Montalcini, and in the equally beautiful book Lessico Familiare by Natalia Ginsburg, who is the daughter of Professor Levi, and describing the personality, extraordinary personality of this man. I still remember this, he was a beautiful lecturer, but extremely demanding, and I have a vivid recollection of my exam with Professor Levi. He asked me a question about the nervous system. Rita Levi-Montalcini was there with Professor Amprino, and at a certain point, the electric power, we had a blackout, so my exam finished with the candlelight, and he gave me 27, that at that time was a very good mark. And so this, I think, it was very important for me to be intern in anatomy, because it was an institute where there was already at that time a strict very focused interest in research, and I remember very well those people.
You graduated in medicine in 1949 at the University of Pisa, where you frequented the medical clinic of Ospedale Santa Chiara, directed by Professor Cataldo Cassano. We know that your interest in renal diseases began in that institute. Could you tell us how it happened?
I left Torino in 46 because my family moved in Tuscany. I had already spent all the year of my liceum in Florence as a student. And so then I moved to the University of Pisa, where the consequence of the war, the destruction, was still very visible, also in the medical school. And my interest in being accepted in the Institute of Professor Cassano was motivated by the fact that the lecture of Professor Cassano were mainly focused on pathogenesis. And so I became interested in the pathogenesis of the disease. I still remember that Professor Cassano was giving a lecture on pathogenesis. We were going on for from one day to another day. And I think this was the important factor in my choice, in spite of the fact that I also took the specialization in pediatrics, so I was also attending the pediatric clinic. My recollection of nephrology at that time is that we had a patient in the pediatric clinic with children with nephrotic syndrome and pneumococcal peritonitis, these children with great severe edema. And in the medical clinic, practically the diagnosis of kidney disease was a diagnosis of death. There was not very much that we could do. But in spite of the fact that there was not very much progress concerning treatment, there was a considerable interest in the pathogenesis. And I remember that Professor Cassano was giving lecture comparing the pathogenesis proposed by Fuller and Farr, which mainly was focused on streptococcal infection, and the pathogenesis and declassification of Ellis. So there was an interest in renal disease. But I think the two important factors in focusing the activity of the clinic, the Department of Internal Medicine in nephrology, was one, the book of Smith on the renal function, which became known thanks to the work of Sergio Giovagnetti and Gigli, which practically translated part of this book. And so we became acquainted with the recent test of renal function for measurement of glomerular filtration rate and the tubular reabsorption. And the second was, the second important fact was the introduction of the percutaneous renal biopsy in the Ospedale di Santa Chiara. Using the test of renal function for measurement of the glomerular filtration rate, we were using sodium thiosulfate, and for the measurement of the tubular function, the paraminopuric acid. We started to work with Professor Fiaschi and Bruno Grassi on patients with diabetes. I think it was this started to be interesting for us because there was the symptom of polyuria, and there was not much information about the mechanism of this polyuria. So we started to study this work on renal function in diabetics and in metabolic, in condition of metabolic compensation and scompensation. And this work went on for 2-3 years. While I was involved in this study, Aldo Torzoli introduced this retroperitoneum with the visualization of the kidney, and with the urologist of Pisa, Professor Togni, the first renal biopsy were performed in Pisa in 51, practically shortly after the paper of Iversen and Broad. And renal biopsy obviously were very important because for the first time it was possible to have information of the renal diseases during the initial stage of the disease and not only the end, the autopsy. So we started to be possible to have information about the morphology of renal diseases already in 52, in spite of the fact that the section and the histology was not really first class. And the reason why I became involved in the work of people who were doing the renal biopsy, especially Ercoli and Fiaschi, was that I was in charge to carry this tissue fragment to Florence, where there was a technician, Ignesti, who was able to cut a relatively thin section, because at Pisa many times the section were probably 10 microns and very difficult to read. And so then I started to work with Ercoli, also because Ercoli, who like me was first in the medical clinic, then he moved as aiuto in the Padiglione Malattie Infettive, in the Department of Infectious Disease. And I was in 51, or in 50, I was moved by Fiaschi, who was a supervisor of this Padiglione Malattie Infettive, which was part of the medical clinic, so the director was Professor Cassano. I was moved by Fiaschi from the medical clinic to the Department of Infectious Disease. And I became one of the two physicians which was in charge in this department. This was a very large department. We had many patients with serious diseases. We had 60 beds, practically 30 beds for men and 30 beds for women. And we were rotating 1 month. I was with the men, 1 month with the women, and we have practically all the patients with tuberculosis, meningitis, typhoid fever, anthrax, brucellosis, so all the possible diseases from an area going from practically La Spezia to Grosseto and Empoli, then large area of Tuscany. And after the war, the infectious diseases were really rampant, so we were extremely busy. I remember we had 10 cases of tetanus, of even more of diphtheria every month. Obviously, at that time, the treatment of this disease was serotherapy. And actually, my first interest in research was that I was asked, because we had so many cases of tetanus, to go to Siena, to the Istituto Sclavo, to learn how to titrate the anti-tetanus toxin. And so then I came back after these 2-3 weeks in Istituto Sclavo in Siena, and I developed a special interest in the tetanus and diphtheria, and especially in the consequence of the treatment of these two diseases, because we were developing, as a consequence of a very large injection of horse serum, we were developing in our inducing in our patient serum sickness. And there were many discussions when this patient will develop acute serum sickness with arthritis and proteinuria, if the proteinuria was due to fever or some immunologic reaction, as the reaction proposed by Baron von Pirke in his studies on serum sickness. So an immunologic reaction. I decided to study some other aspects of renal disease, and my interest was in the mechanism of proteinuria in acute serum sickness. So this was probably my second area of interest, even if I could not really, we have not the possibility to take a biopsy of this patient because they have diphtheria and tetanus, and we, in spite of the fact that there was not the committee on human subject at that time, we didn't really thought that would have been moral to take biopsy in these people. And there was a certain influence, obviously, of other people in the study of possibility that antigen, the renal disease may be due to an immunologic reaction. And this person probably had more influence in this type of, in developing this concept, was Dr. Benedetti, who is now professor of cell biology at the University of Pavia. He was in the Institute of Pathologic Anatomy, and I had frequent opportunity, together with Dr. Fiaschi, to discuss with Benedetti this topic, and he was, I remember, the first to suggest that perhaps a method for localization of antibody in tissue and more powerful instrument of resolution like the electron microscope could have been useful for the study of the pathogenesis of renal disease. This was really in the early 50s, so before this proposal could become a reality. But anyway, this discussion were already very much alive in Pisa, and I remember that period with great nostalgia and with great sympathy.
Professor Andres, in 1956, you left Rome, where Professor Cassano and his group had moved, to spend a period in the United States of America. Why did you leave Italy?
Professor Cassano was offered the possibility to go to Rome in 1955. So it became evident that he was going to Rome with a small group of people of his institute, including Professor Fiaschi and some other. I was not offered the opportunity to go to Rome. And so I thought that I would have had the opportunity to continue to work in Pisa, and I was offered the position of assistente volontario in the Institute of Professor Tronchetti, who was, this was my first academic appointment, who was the person that took the chair of Pathologia Medica in the University of Pisa. Professor Tronchetti was the aiuto of Professor Cassano. So I was, this was my first appointment in Pisa. Then, again in 55, Professor Cassano became a member of a commission of the Istituto Nazionale delle Assicurazioni, for a commission, for a fellowship, for international fellowship. This was a single position. And Professor Cassano was moving to Rome, so he was leaving the Pisa, and there was a little bit of uncertainty what would have been the future of the people working with him. Fiaschi for sure was going with Professor Cassano in Rome. So when Professor Cassano said, I am in a commission, perhaps I will have a chance to help somebody to have this fellowship, who want to apply? Practically I was the one who said that wanted to apply because I thought perhaps this will be an important experience for me. I will work with Professor Tronchetti in Pisa, and so then for the first time, I must say, I studied very hard, and I went to Rome, and there was this kind of exam. I'm sure Professor Cassano was a great help to me, and so I was the winner of this concorso, and I got this fellowship. It was 1 milione di lire, not really very much, including the ticket for the trip. But there was not the slightest idea where I was going to go, because there were no information. So I remember that I took a book, the most recent book, with the name of American authors, which I could find in Pisa, which, by the way, was a book of endocrinology. And I found that there was a person who in Philadelphia who had written a chapter on diabetes. So I, with my fellowship, I applied for this position, and I was accepted. But then I had a problem, because at that time really was nobody was going to, very few people were going to the United States, especially without a very clear objective. And finally, after many difficulties, I got a visa from the American consulate in Florence, and I didn't realize that this visa was for a position of resident. So when I arrived in the United States, I realized that I was supposed to do a clinical work, and this was not my desire. I wanted to go in an institute to learn something about research. So then I had serious problem with the immigration office in New York, because I said that I was not really, I didn't want to go in this hospital that, after all, was not in Philadelphia, but was in New Jersey, a small hospital. This was a good hospital, but there was no program of research. Fortunately, because I was arriving in the United States 1 month in advance, which in advance to the period I was supposed to start this new job, I visited in New York all the medical school. And so I had the opportunity also to visit Colombia, and I was told by some Italian working there, especially the person who was really of great help for me was Professor Lattes, Professor of Clinical Pathology. He was one of the person who in Torino was already a distinguished surgeon. He was obliged to leave Italy for the Russian law, and Professor Lattes was very helpful to give me information. So I decided that really I wanted to go to Colombia, and I asked Dr. Loeb, thanks to also to the Dr. Lattes, who was my intermediary, to be accepted as a fellow, because I had my fellowship. And so I became a fellow in internal medicine with Dr. Loeb, and this was the kind of rather tortuous trip which brought me to Colombia. But in answering your question, was really difficult, at least for me it was difficult, because I didn't have any precise idea where to go, and at that time to have a fellowship was very difficult. I am still very grateful to Professor Cassano, who was instrumental in obtaining this fellowship for me.
Professor Andres, at Columbia University, you worked with Dr. Loeb and Dr. Beatrice Siegel. This cooperation produced, in 1959, the very first paper on immunofluorescence applied to renal biopsy. How this investigation, important investigation, started?
As I told you before, So I became an intern in the department of a fellow, the department of medicine of Dr. Loeb. At that time, Dr. Robert Friedrich Loeb was really the leading clinicians, together with Walter Bauer at Harvard, that was a leading clinicians in the United States. And he had formed probably one of the most authoritative department in that country. Just to mention a few, there was Dickinson and Cournand, the Nobel Prize for catheterism, Regan, the rheumatologist, Rose, the expert infectious disease, Chargraff, who established the pairing of the bases, which was instrumental for the description of the double helix of DNA, etc. And Dr. Loeb was a great scientist of its own right. Dr. Loeb was the man who discovered that the adrenal controlled the metabolism of salt and water, and was a kind of legendary to tell to the student how Dr. Loeb discovered this association, because he had been a physician in the Balkan War, and he saw many people dying of cholera, that they were dying for dehydration. So he observed that patients with Addison coma also were dying for the dehydration, suggesting that the adrenals, because Addison disease at that time was considered a disease produced by tuberculosis of the adrenal, that the adrenal were controlling metabolism of salt and water. So he did the classic experiment of bilateral adrenalectomy in the dog, demonstrating that the dog were dying with the loss of salt and water, and was possible to correct the Addison coma in dogs by administration of salt and water. So Dr. Loeb was really a very prestigious scientist. But then when he became a chairman, I said, now I want to concentrate on the building a strong department, and I will no longer work in research. But he was the person who had the great experience in research, and he was the person who was giving lecture in nephrology and diabetes at Columbia. So I had the opportunity several times to ask him about concerning visiting patients with renal disease, some question about the pathogenesis of renal diseases, using as a background my little experience in renal biopsy, because at that time, in 56, 57, renal biopsy were not performed at Columbia. So I had a great advantage, and when I was telling them, but perhaps it would be necessary to perform a renal biopsy, they were surprised that this could be done. But the major influence, I think, a major concept was that renal diseases were due to streptococcal infection. And I remember to have asked Dr. Loeb, when there was a patient with renal disease, what do you think may be due to this disease? And due to the fact that in the department, some people were really involved in the study of the association of streptococcal infection and the renal disease, especially by measuring the anti-streptolysin titer, Dr. Loeb told me, well, perhaps the renal disease is due to the fact that when we have a streptococcal angina, then the streptococcal toxin localizes in the kidney because the streptococcal toxin has a certain polarity for the kidney. And then later on, when there is, after this famous period of latency, which was well described by von Pirquet, when there is the immune response to this antigen localized in the kidney, then there is an inflammatory reaction in the kidney. And this is mechanism is similar to nephrotoxic nephritis, when we have this anti-kidney serum which localizes in the kidney, and then there is the, as demonstrated by Kay, there is the autologous response and the development of kidney disease. And the person who may tell you something more is Dr. Siegel, who is working at that time, medicine was a 9th floor, is working at the 12th floor, so I think you should go there. So it was thanks to Dr. Loeb that made this connection. Especially it was strong because the wife of Dr. Loeb, Emily Loeb, was working with Dr. Siegel on experimental renal disease. So I was introduced to Dr. Siegel, and this was the Dr. Loeb was the link between the Department of Microbiology and the Department of Medicine. So then I started to go to work to work in the laboratory of Dr. Beatrice Siegel, and I realized it was a very important laboratory because Dr. Siegel was the chairman of the Department of Microbiology, soon to be succeeded by Dr. Rose. And Dr. Siegel was deeply involved in the study of streptococcal infection and renal disease because she had published in 1953 a very important paper in Journal Experimental Medicine with the with Earl, who was one of his pupils. And then he became one of the chief nephrologists in Chicago, with Janis, one of the group doing renal biopsy in the United States. And she has published this paper with the Emily Loeb, in, as I said, in 53, on the elevation of the anti-streptolysin titer in patients with renal disease. And so there was a great interest in this association. In addition, at that time, there was in the laboratory Dr. Siegel, John Zabriskie, who was a pupil of Lansfield and MacLean McCarthy, who were the leading experts, as you know, in streptococcal infection, the Lansfield classification of various types, various strains of strep. And John Zabriskie was sent in the laboratory of Dr. Siegel with the purpose to study the association between streptococcal infection and acute rheumatic fever. So they were using anti-streptococcal sera, especially prepared against group A strep, to the study of heart for patients with died of rheumatic fever. At that time was still rather frequent, and for the study of the antigenic mimicry between streptococcal antigen and myocardial tissue. So this work was one of the main interests of Dr. Siegel. And so I, going in this laboratory, I became involved in the study of streptococcal infection, and especially I became acquainted of these people. I became a friend of John Zabriskie, and I started to go to Rockefeller Institute. I met Dr. McCarthy. I met Mrs. Lansfield. She was a technician, so when she did this extraordinary important work of classification of streptococcal strain. And I think to go into the, what at that time was called Rockefeller Institute was a great experience for me, because I think it was practically, as you know, was the institute which was instrumental in the progress of American medicine at the beginning of the century, because Flexner was a professor at Rockefeller, and the American Medical School started a reform which brought them to the present position of leadership thanks to the famous Flexner reform of the medical school. So then I was going with them in this dining room, and I was told, this is Dr. Kunkel, this is Dr. McCarthy. So these famous people, I still remember, was quite an experience. So Dr. Siegel was a good place for the study of renal disease. And And in addition, Dr. Siegel gave me an assignment. He said, you should review what is the evidence that the immunological mechanism produced injury in tissue. So then I spent a lot of time in the library reviewing all the available evidence, and I came up with information that I published with Dr. Siegel. I think there were about 20 or 30, 40 references at that time, with special emphasis, obviously, on the experiment, the only model of experimental nephritis which was available, which was nephrotoxic nephritis. And Dr. Siegel was very much involved in trying to use nephrotoxic nephritis for the equalocalization of antigen and the antibody. So these were the two places where, which gave me, were my springboard for my introduction in the field of nephrology.
Professor Andres, how did you have the idea of applying immunofluorescence to renal biopsies? And then, what difficulties and pitfalls did you find in the application of immunofluorescence to renal samples?
When I arrived in the laboratory of Beatrice Siegel, she was involved, as I said before, with already in studies of immunofluorescence with John Zabrinsky for the study of rheumatic fever. In addition, there were several other people working there. It was a very active laboratory. There was Dr. Earle working with the streptococcal antigen. Dr. Middleton was working on nephrotoxic nephritis. Dr. Metzger, who then went to the NIH, and he's a very authoritative scientist on IgA and immediate hypersensitivity. And Dr. Siegel was one of the two laboratories in New York City trying to develop the immunofluorescence method. The other laboratory was the laboratory at the Sloan Kettering, the laboratory of Robert Mellors. And Robert Mellors had already published one paper on the localization of nephrotoxic sera in glomeruli of rat with nephrotoxic nephritis. This was in the tradition of the study of the department of Professor Fitzgerald, where there was Dr. Pressman, who was the first to show by using radioimmunological method that the nephrotoxic sera localized in glomeruli. And then by using autoradiography to show this, to confirm this localization. So the laboratory of the Sloan Kettering was already involved in this type of studies. At Columbia, Dr. Siegel was the other person who was following the same trend of research. The reason why Dr. Siegel was doing this type of work was because she was trained at Harvard together with David Siegel, her husband, who was professor of medicine at Columbia and director of the Goldwater Hospital on Roosevelt Island. And Dr. Siegel at Harvard had been a classmate of Alfred Kunz. So she was very aware of the the importance of the immunofluorescence. And I was still frequently going to Boston to discuss and to with Dr. Kunz the progress of her work. Actually, I remember that once Dr. Siegel took me with her to Boston, and I still remember this tea offered by Dr. Kunz in the department, and I remember that we asked Dr. Kunz how he developed immunofluorescence, and he told us that as a student he went to Berlin, because at that time, before the war, in the Berlin was the center of medical research, and he at that time in Berlin he developed the idea that would have been very important in order to show that inflammatory reaction studied by especially by Konheim in Germany were due to immunological mechanisms. It would have been very important to show that the antigen and the antibody were present at the site of the lesions. So Dr. Kunz, going back after this fellowship to Boston, met with some friend in biochemistry and told him that it would have been possible perhaps to conjugate antibody, actually at that time it was antibody, this word didn't exist, gamma globulin, so the serum, the antiserum, with tracers visible in the fluorescent microscope. So he did this first study before the war, labeling antipneumococcal sera, and showed that these antipneumococcal sera were binding to pneumococci. And Dr. Kunz told us about the difficulty to use a fluorescent scope. At Harvard, there was only a very rudimental scope. And that he wrote a manuscript, then he was, there was the Second World War started, he was in the Pacific when, in the army, when he was told that his paper had been published, the first paper on immunofluorescence. After the war, it became evident, thanks to the work of Pressman and the work of Mellors and Siegel, that it would have been possible probably to study antigen-antibody reaction in tissue, not only in bacteria. And so this was the beginning of these studies. Then when I arrived at Columbia and I told Dr. Siegel and Dr. Loeb that we were doing renal biopsy and would have been possible to use human tissue, then Dr. Siegel was more than happy to try to use immunofluorescence in the study of renal biopsy. And this collaboration started because I started to receive I told this to Professor Fiaschi, who was in Rome with Professor Cassano. I told him about this possibility. So we started this collaboration between Rome and Columbia, and they were performing biopsy in Rome, sending this biopsy with a thermos. I was going to Idlewild Airport, at that time it was not called Kennedy, to collect this thermos, which were brought by a pilot of the Alitalia, and which was that we knew, I knew well because he came to ask me advice at Columbia because his wife had leukemia. So it was really very, very important, this Comandante Campagnano, in taking responsibility of carrying this biopsy. And so we started the study of immunofluorescence, or human renal biopsy, which was the first in the United States, because Dr. Mellors, which was a couple of steps ahead of us, he was already started to study human tissue, but autopsy tissue. But we were studying biopsy tissue. But while we started to do this work, Dr. Mellors in New York was already doing this type of work on autopsy tissue. How difficult, you ask me? It was very difficult for two reasons. First, because we had to cut this very tiny fragment, so every section was very important, not to lose any section, and we had very good technicians, but I had also learned to cut section. And the microtome was very rudimental, it was a far cry from the modern microtomes, cryostat. And the second was the fact that at Columbia we were trying to use anti-human gamma globulin serum. And so we were preparing with the help of Dr. Xu this fraction, because you have to know that in Colombia, just across the corridor, there was the great laboratory of Elvin Cabat, the father of immunochemistry, together with his teacher, Professor Heidelberger. And Cabat was the person who had shown, working with Tiselius, that the gamma globulin fraction contained antibodies. So, because there was the tradition that the work of one group was also discussed by all the other group, the work that we were doing was discussed by Cabat, by Rose, by Morgan, by Beiser, by Erlanger, by all these leading immunologists in the department. And Cabat told us, well, in order to show that you have an antigen-antibody reaction, you have to use the gamma globulin fraction. So I remember this separation of gamma globulin, this separating with the sodium thiosulfate, the various Kuhn's fraction, was a major endeavor. The other problem was that in Colombia there didn't exist a fluorescent microscope. The only microscope available, the one that they had, the Sloan Kettering, the one of Robert Mellos, was not available to us, obviously. Was a competitor. The only other microscope was in the Roosevelt Hospital in the department of David Siegel, Dr. Essam. And so we were taking this try with the section already stained, and I was taking the A train going to 97, and then the crosstown bus, and then I was taking the elevator to the Roosevelt Island, and then there was this huge microscope, and only when there was what today we would say a 5+ positivity was possible to see something. So every time there was this definition, is it positive, is negative, is little more than background staining, so it was very difficult decision. Very difficult decision, especially when we were coming to the problem of localization of antigen. Because at that time, always on the basis of the work of nephrotoxic nephritis, which was the Bible, practically, of nephrology, it was necessary to show not only the immunoglobulin, but also the antigen. So the antigen at that time was considered to be the streptococcal antigen by definition. And so we were using all the streptococcal sera prepared by Rockefeller, by Dr. Lansfield, Dr. McCarthy, and brought to the laboratory by John Zabriskie for the localization of streptococcal antigen in glomeruli. So one of the first major problems we had, which led us to a major error that I still blush when I see Michael, who is now dean of the medical school in Minneapolis, we laugh about this because of the Dr. Michael, who was one of the first in the famous group of Robert Good in Minneapolis to study renal biopsy. As I told you, I will tell you before why Minneapolis was so important. And also Dr. Michael came up with the first paper together with our paper that perhaps streptococcal antigen was localized in glomeruli. I don't know if perhaps in some biopsy we may have been right, but you know very well that the issue of streptococcal antigen in glomeruli is still unsettled. Probably we made some error and we published a paper saying that there was streptococcal antigen in glomeruli, which I think was deadly wrong, because one of the patients had membranous glomerulonephritis, and probably the tissue was positive because this was some rheumatoid factor which was picking up any antisera. So the difficulty, because the technique was very rudimental, and this I think tell you enough also because about difficulty, also because we were too much polarized on this concept that the streptococcus was the responsible for all renal diseases.
Professor Andres, during your first period in the United States, you visited several scientists active in the field of renal diseases. What impressions did you get from these visits, and what differences did you find between the American and Italian academical medicine?
Yes, it was in 57 that I went around visiting some of the renal group. And in order to do so, the introduction of Dr. Siegel was extremely important, because Dr. Siegel was one of the few persons who was instrumental in organizing with Jack Metcalf, who was the real leader, the first group of the first conference on kidney, as we will discuss later on, the annual conference on the nephrotic syndrome. And so she knew everybody, also because some of these people had been in her laboratory, like Earl. And so I remember to have been in Washington to visit the group of Parrish and Howe. I was in Chicago, where I met Dr. Kark and Pirani. In Chicago, also, I met Earle, who was a pupil, as I said, of Dr. Siegel. He was chief of medicine at Northwestern University. And Dr. Jennings, who became a friend of mine, and who was the pathologist, was one of the group with Kark doing renal biopsy in the United States. Then I went to visit a friend of Dr. Siegel, Dr. Goodman, who was the head of the NIH, the immunology laboratory of the NIH, and Baxter and Goodman were working on nephrotoxic nephritis, trying to localize the nephrotoxic antigen. And I went to Boston and I met Genevieve, who was a friend, a classmate of Dr. Siegel. He was a chief of pediatrics in the Children's Hospital. And in New York, obviously, Dr. Churg and Grishman, who were at the Mount Sinai Hospital. In addition, in Cleveland, I met Dr. Heyman, who was a pediatrician, and he was very much interested in nephrology. And Dr. Heyman, I became a friend, and I have continued to follow also the work of his pupil. Also Dr. Heyman was a friend of Dr. Siegel. what was my impression? Well, these people were mainly working on the renal biopsy, like the group of Kark and Jennings and Parrish and Howe. And the importance of renal biopsy in the diagnosis of renal disease. And I was not really, had no impression that they were very far ahead of us. We were doing this already in Pisa. And the quality of the section was not really superior to ours. The technical problem was a critical importance, so we were always looking if the section were readable or not. But I became interested in the work of Dr. Goodman, who became the chief of the WHO in Geneva, and because he was, when he was at the NIH, he was trying to localize nephrotoxic antigen. And in the work of Dr. Heyman, who was trying to study the pathogenesis of this nephrosis in rat immunized with homogenate of rat tissue. So I learned a little bit concerning pathogenesis, but not very much about the morphology. I think at Columbia was practically head of everybody else for what concern idea and the pathogenesis of the disease. Perhaps only the group of Mellers was so much involved in the pathogenesis. The other group were more involved in morphology and diagnosis. Dr. Siegel was involved in the organization of the annual conference of nephrotic syndrome. And while I was at Columbia, I had the possibility to study very carefully the proceedings of the previous meeting. Practically, the annual conference started at the level of the 40. And so I became acquainted for the first time with the work of Vincent Hall. He was the director of the electron microscopy laboratory of the Argonne National Institute. And in 53 and in 54, at the annual conference, he presented the first study of electron microscopy of renal glomeruli. And these studies were, for me, were extremely revealing, because it was evident that this new technique would have been basic importance for the understanding the pathogenesis of renal diseases. In addition, in this volume of the annual conference of nephrotic syndrome, I found the work of the Boston group of Hume, Merrill, Murray, and concerning allogeneic, the transplantation in twins, and the first experience in allogeneic renal transplantation. Then there was the work of Goldblatt on hypertension, the work of Louis Thomas, who was professor of pathology at the time of the NIU, on Schwarzman reaction and the lesions produced by Schwarzman reaction and coagulation in the kidney. The work on BSA of Genevay. I would like to spend a few words about this, because Genevay, as I told you, was a pediatrician at the Children's Hospital, was a friend, a classmate of Dr. Siegel, and with Dr. Siegel had been involved in the study supported by the American government during the First World War of trying to use bovine serum albumin as a succedaneous for human plasma in the people wounded on the battlefield. So they did some experience in injecting BSA in men and then studying the immune response to BSA. This original work is published in the Ziegler, in the classic book of microbiology, in the first edition. And obviously, they had to stop because they were producing lesions, which I think in a few people resulted in the death of the people, of the person. And there was also in the annual proceedings of the annual conference the work described the work of Goodman and Baxter on the identification of nephrotoxic antigen by using serological method, and also the work of the group of Kark and the group of Parrish and Howe on renal biopsy. So I realized from the study of the first volume of these annual proceedings of the nephrotic syndrome, which is very interesting even today to read, because I find interesting observation and ideas which would deserve perhaps to going back to the laboratory and doing some work in these proceedings, which lasted until 1963. Then the annual proceedings, the annual conference of the nephrotic syndrome became the National Kidney Disease Foundation, which was the forerunner of the American Society of Nephrology. In 1957, the proceedings of the conference on the nephrotic syndrome was held at the NIH, and Dr. Siegel took me with her, and it was the first time that in this conference the study of immunofluorescence were presented. So Dr. Siegel presented her work on localization of immunoglobulin interact of glomeruli with the nephrotoxic nephritis and localization of the antigen. At the same conference, there was Dr. Metcalf, who presented the first study some steroid treatment in patients with renal disease, I remember that visit to Washington also because it was my first visit to a medical library. I went to see this fabulous medical library of the Walter Reed Institute, which is in a place in this red building, which is in front of the Smithsonian Institute now. Obviously, this was the library which then became the National Library of the NIH, one of the main building of the NIH, where practically today there is everything. But at that time, the medical library of the armed forces was very important for all the scientists, especially nephrologists working around the world, because it was very generous in providing, upon request, the microfilm of the paper. In this way, I became in possession of the microfilm of the original work of Masugi, of the work of Smadel, or the work of Oliver, the work of Fuller and Farr, which in Italy were not available after the war. And so I remember this visit was the first visit to a medical library with great pleasure. I still remember this balcony and people who were going to collect the books, and it was, I think, a very interesting experience. In addition, I have to mention another thing, because we are talking about 57. That was the year in which Farquhar, Vernier, and Good published the landmark paper on the ultrastructure of human renal disease in a classic paper in Journal Experimental Medicine. That was the paper, the first application of electron microscopy to the study of renal disease, human renal disease, with the demonstration that foreign deposits were present in glomeruli. Still, there is this huge sub-endothelial deposits of electron-dense material in the picture published in that paper. And this paper was published because Bob Vernier was the first to start the renal biopsy in Minneapolis, together with Good, who was the professor of pediatrics. And at that time, Marilyn Farquhar, who started to do electron microscopy in San Francisco with Professor Randerat, she was a technician of Randerat and was extremely gifted in sectioning and developing the best possible technique. And she moved, I think, to Minneapolis with her husband. And so the group of the nephrologists of Minneapolis had the possibility to give the renal biopsy to Marilyn. Marilyn at that time had published in Laboratory Investigation the first usable technique for the fixation of tissue using the osmium tetroxide, which was developed in 1955 by George Palade, the Rockefeller Institute. This is Dr. Palade. For the fixation of tissue, this is Dr. Palade. With me, but this is later on. This is, it's in 75 in Buffalo. And Dr. Farquhar so was able to make this original observation, and this paper had a great influence on me because in addition to the work, original work of Vincent Hall on destruction of normal glomeruli in rat, this was the first study showing that this new powerful tool, the electron microscope, would have been usable for the study of renal disease. So the possibility to investigate localization of antigen antibody by the light microscope and the possibility to study the renal lesions by the electron microscope, for me, at that time, in 57, became the two most important avenue for research for the future. And from that point, I started to be rather skeptical of the all these morphologic studies, which, yes, we were doing already in Pisa, the morphology of renal disease. But in order to learn something about the pathogenesis of the renal disease, we had to use new tools. And this work of Farquhar was really very important for me. Probably you can see the paper of Marilyn here. This is sitting on my desk. And this is the group of Dr. Farquhar, this Dr. Keriaski and Dr. Miettinen. This is in Sant'Antonio when Dr. Farquhar had the Wilson Medal, the highest honor of the American Society of Nephrology, and I was in charge to introduce Marilyn. And this is Dr. Henry Mauvat, who was also at that time one of the scientists who gave a major contribution to the development of the study of ultrastructure of the kidney. So in 57, my interest was focused on this new type of research. And I, as I told you, I was already starting to know how fantastic institute for research was the Rockefeller. And so because at Rockefeller there was the notoriously the strongest group in electron microscopy, was the group of Claude, Porter, and Pallad. The Porter is the person who took the first picture of a cell by electron microscopy. Pallad had developed a fixative. They had discovered the endoplasmic reticulum, Porter, Pallad, the ribosome. They were doing this work which led to the Nobel Prize and per Pallad and Claude and the Duve. And so my interest would have been to go to Rockefeller, but when I asked Dr. Porter if I could go to as a fellow in his laboratory, he had already two very good Italian, Giuseppe Milloning and Carlo Bruni, who did very important work at that time, and Milloning is the author of the Millonic fixative, and Bruni was working on liver. And in addition, Marilyn Farquhar has already obtained a position in the laboratory of Dr. Pallade. So it would have been difficult for me. And so the only place who was doing similar work at that in 57 had published a paper on electron microscopy of the kidney was Anders Bergstrand in Stockholm. The two papers on electron microscopy of the kidney are Farquhar and Bergstrand.
Thus, Professor Andres, at this point of your career, you decided to go to Karolinska Institute in Stockholm to do electron microscopy studies. What were the difficulties and the pitfalls associated with this investigation at that time? And what results did you take back from your experience at Karolinska?
As I told you, the reason why I decided to learn electron microscopy was because the work of Vincent Hall, and because in 57 these two important papers, the one of Marilyn Farquhar and in Journal Experimental Medicine and the one of Anders Bergstrand on laboratory investigation were published. And I told you that Rockefeller was difficult for me to go there, so the other possibility was to go to Karolinska. So I apply and I got a fellowship at the Svenska Institute, and there was not a difficult choice because the Rockefeller Institute and the Karolinska Institute at that time were the two lighthouse of for ultrastructural studies. And obviously at Rockefeller, the group of Claude, Porter and Palade had already provided very important contribution. But also in Sweden, the School of Electron Microscopy was very advanced because it was the school of Professor Sjöstrand. And with Rudin, who was the first to study the structure of renal tubules, and Bergstrand, and many others of pupil of Sjöstrand, which were in Gothenburg and in other universities. And there was a certain kind of competition between Rockefeller and Karolinska, especially because, as it's easy to understand, at that time there were some controversy concerning interpretation of the findings. One of the most celebrated was the one of the existence of the ribosome, Palade suggesting, showing that the ribosome did exist thanks to this work and the work of Isikevitz on the synthesis of protein, and Sjöstrand, which at that time was considering that the ribosome were artifact. And obviously the method and the development of the various techniques was this key important in order the importance in order to obtain reliable result. And obviously the problem of fixation, the problem of sectioning, the problem of staining of the section were all important for the interpretation of the finding. And in addition, the quality of the electron microscope was so important. So you have to consider that the electron microscope was developed in Germany, in Berlin, by Ruska. And so in Sweden, they had the best electron microscope. They had this fantastic Siemens, while in the United States, they had the RCA, which were not so good. But in the field of fixative and in the field of sectioning, the group of Rockefeller was far ahead. The progress then was also made by the introduction by Harrison Latta of the glass knife. But a Rockefeller reporter has developed the first rotary microtome. And so these two places, Rockefeller and Karolinska, was the two places, good places to learn electron microscopy. Dr. Bergstrand was a pathologist, and he was studying with Dr. Bucht, who was the clinical, the nephrologist. He was taking the biopsy. He started to study the patient with amyloid and diabetes. So were two diseases which are not so interesting for me, but practicing in his laboratory was very important because I learned the basic technique. And I did work with Jan Eriksson, who then he became professor of pathology in Uppsala, and I study aminonucleoside nephropathy. So then I published with Jan Eriksson in American Journal of Pathology, one of the first papers with the one of Dr. Vernier on the ultrastructure of aminonucleoside nephropathy, especially showing that multiple injection produce chronic renal disease, which at that time was not known because it was considered the experimental model of the nephrotic syndrome of children, as was called at that time. So in addition, in Stockholm, I started to receive also for my connection with Dr. Naccarato and Dr. Fiaschi some biopsy in Stockholm. And we study also with Dr. Bergstrand some biopsy coming from Rome. So this was the period in which I suggested, we were frequently exchange correspondence with Dr. Fiaschi. Dr. Fiaschi and I don't remember who was, but I think it was Dr. Fiaschi who wrote me a letter and said that there is the possibility that Professor Cassano may be in charge of what were called in Italia relazione al Congresso Nazionale di Medicina Interna, a kind of report to the National Congress of Internal Medicine. And we could, on the basis of what you tell me, we could perhaps provide some new contribution on the field of renal disease. It was at that time, when I was in Stockholm, that we started to discuss this joint work. And this was also important for me for going back to Rome from Stockholm. And at that time, I left Pisa. My appointment was in Pisa, and in spite of the fact that, as you know, in Italy situations are very difficult, I didn't have any, the only position I had was in the University of Pisa. I went to Rome in order to do this work with Dr. Fiaschi.
Professor Anders, after your period at Karolinska Institute, you went back to Rome, where you and the other members of Cassano groups worked hard to prepare an intervention on the nephrotic syndrome for the 61st Congress of the Italian Society of Internal Medicine. What were the main features of this important intervention?
The most part of the writing work was done by Professor Fiaschi. And the clue of this presentation was the result of electron microscopy and immunofluorescence of kidney disease. And I realized at that time, the meeting was held in Naples in the October 1960, that there were other Italians doing work in electron microscopy, and especially from Milan, Folli e Onida, that they were doing very good work of electron microscopy, and Folli had published an important paper with the collaboration of the Chicago group of Kark and Pirani on the restoration of the position of the food process in children with nephrotic syndrome treated with steroid. So I met this Italian for the first time. And the meeting was special importance for me, because the alternative was to stay in Italy, as Professor Cassano proposed me, or to return in the United States, following my inclination to continue to hunting for immune deposits and antigen antibody reaction in tissue. But in 1960, I think there were two important meetings which I would like to mention, which I think left a mark in the development of nephrology. And one was the first Congress of the International Society of Nephrology in Evian. And I vividly remember that meeting, especially for two presentations. One was Professor Ambourget, who dramatically presented on the podium the first patient with renal transplant, which was came from Paris, and everybody had became aware that a new era was opening for nephrology with kidney transplantation. The second was another of stunning performances of Marilyn Farquhar with Pallade, which presented all this beautiful work on vascular permeability using ferritin as tracers, and the perfection of the technique, which was the characteristic, a kind of fingerprint of the Rockefeller University, was such that everybody remained astonished to see how this molecule was slowly going through the glomerular capillary wall. So that presentation gave me another, confirmed my idea that really Marilyn Farquhar was the person to watch in order to follow the progress of nephrology.
Another important event was in 1961, when the CIBA Symposium on Renal Biopsy was held in London. We know that you and Professor Ernie Kofiaski attended that symposium. What is your recollection of this important symposium?
I was aware of this symposium when I was in Stockholm because Dr. Bergstrand was invited. But we were not invited, and so I didn't expect to go there. But when we were in Rome, a certain day I was in charge of the ward with renal patient in Rome. At that time there was not a chair of nephrology, but I was in charge of renal disease. And a certain day, Sir Walter Stone came, on a short notice, came to see the Professor Fiaschi. So probably because he was impressed talking with Fiaschi, and we got his invitation, but not as a member of the official program. In fact, our name is not on the program. So then we went to London. I remember we were really like persons who were not invited, so we're like auditors. And we extended all this presentation. And I think that at a certain point, we were asked to summarize the experience, but both done in an informal way, telling them what we were doing. So the presentation didn't have very much relevance. But for me, it was very important, that meeting, because it was a meeting of morphologists. And I had the clear impression that the progress of nephrology was no longer of morphology, but was in other areas. And so I came back and I remember that I told Fiaschi, but look, we know more than all of them. And I think that this is not the time to insist on this morphology, trying to classify the renal disease. Yes, this is important, but let them do these things. We have to try to do something different. And this was especially true because I already had a certain plan in my head. And in the very important information that I had at that time were two. One, the classic publication of John Singer in Nature that was possible to conjugate antibody with a tracer visible by electron microscopy. This was a paper of biochemistry showing that the conjugation of antibody with ferritin does not prevent the capacity of the antibody to bind to the respective antigen. This was very important because I was always in contact with Dr. Siegel, and she told me, look, now there is this paper. Our laboratory of electron microscopy, which was a laboratory, was the leading laboratory in the United States and in the world for virology with Morgan and Rose. Our laboratory will try to use this method to apply for the first time with the method for the study of virus, how viruses and the entry and the exit from the cell. Would be wonderful if in the future we would try to develop a technique for using this type of label antibody for the identification of antigen antibody reaction in tissue. So this was the one of the things which I had in mind already. at the time of the London conference. The second was the second piece of information that I got from New York by my direct, by my red line with Dr. Siegel, was that in 1960, the annual conference on nephrotic syndrome was organized by Dr. Siegel at Columbia. And was in this meeting that Dixon presented his first data on the development of a new model resembling the spectrum of human glomerulonephritis by multiple immunization, the so-called chronic serum sickness, especially by showing with the work with Feldman, who was doing electron microscopy at the Scripps Clinic, by showing that in this type of glomerulonephritis, there were electron-dense deposits similar to the one shown by Farquhar in renal biopsy. So for the first time, we had a model which at variance from the Masugi nephritis, nephrotoxic nephritis, which is not characterized by presence of electron-dense deposits, which for me were the hallmark of human disease, were clearly visible in the Dixon model. So I knew that there was a model and that there was the new method, the method of John Singer. So for me, this information was important for two reasons. One, for my decision to go back to Colombia, as was asked me by Dr. Siegel and Dr. Morgan. And two, to decline this offer of Professor Cassano to stay in Rome, because I thought that that would have been the time to try to learn more in nephrology, something which would have been very difficult for me to do in Rome. And this was also for other reasons, but was the end of my collaboration with Fiaschi, who at that time he got a chair of internal medicine, first in Cagliari and then in Padova, and he moved there.
Thus, from 1961 to 1963, you were back as a research fellow to Columbia University. This time, you worked with Dr. Siegel and Dr. Morgan on experimental nephritis with ferritin-conjugated antibody. What were the difficulties you met with this technique that you also defined as an impossible new method, which led to results that you published in Nature and in the Journal of Experimental Medicine?
So you have to consider that really the real issue was to try to convincingly show that the foreign deposits shown for the first time by Marilyn Farquhar were indeed the same thing as the immune deposit detected by immunofluorescence. So we had the morphology and immunology, but what's necessary in order to show convincingly to combine these two observations to show that they were really the same things. And because now it seems to be obvious, but at that time, entire meeting were dedicated to this issue, discussion, and people in favor and people against. So this was the aim. And we thought that the model provided by nephrotoxic nephritis and the model of chronic serum sickness of Dixon would have been worth of investigation with the new method of John Singer. At that time, the immunoperoxidase technique didn't exist. So I went back to Colombia, and this, as I told you before, was a rather difficult decision because it was practically a kissing goodbye to my career in Italy. But I thought it would have been important for me to continue this line of research. And I went back as a fellow of the John Whitney Foundation. The method of Singer was working well for Morgan because he was taking cells of viruses, pellet with viruses, and was mixing with the conjugated antibody and then embedding the pellets, and there was the problem was solved. But with tissue, we rapidly realized that there was almost insurmountable difficulty was the fact that the ferritin is 800,000 molecular weight, the IgG 160, so it's almost 1 million, and this huge molecule did not penetrate in tissue. And when we have renal tissue or any other tissue, especially compact tissue, as muscles or even interstitial renal tissue, practically there is no penetration. So for almost 2 years I was struggling with this problem. Is the conjugation doesn't work? Is the fact that we didn't have good penetration? We have denatured the antigen in tissue with fixation? And practically we thought that there was no solution. Until Dr. Gabriel Gadman, a great friend of mine, was professor, is still emeritus professor of pathology at Columbia, he suggested several tricks. And so by trial and errors, we were able to find a certain combination between a mild fixative, the paraformaldehyde, and the mincing of tissue in order to allow penetration of antibody, the antibody conjugated with ferritin in structure like renal glomeruli. So finally, we were able to obtain a reliable result, because at a certain point we were also in doubt about the validity of our control, because we were exposing so much of the section to an old RCA microscope that we had a lot of contamination forming all this black spot, this little black spot resembling ferritin. So the black spot were not in the right place. And so finally we adjust the technique, and we had this reliable result, and we were able to publish the technique of localization of nephrotoxic serum in Nature, and this was a paper which had a considerable, was well received, and because it became possible that the electron microscope would have been usable for investigation of antigen-antibody reaction in tissue, something that then has been improved with immunoperoxidase, with the colloidal gold, and in other method, more simple method that we are using today. Then in 1961, there were two important events. One was the publication of Dixon, Feldman, and Vasquez of the paper that Dixon had presented at the annual meeting of the annual conference of the nephrotic syndrome the year before. It was officially published in the journal Experimental Medicine, and that paper was really very important because that paper showed that the two things. One, that there were electron dense deposits comparable to the one of the human disease. And second, that different type, and this is very clearly stated in the paper, different type of morphologic lesions may be produced by the intensity and the quality of the antibody response. And this was, I think, the first time that was clearly stated as something which was reiterated by Dixon in his Harvey lecture of 63 to the New York Academy of Medicine, that the quality and the quantity of the antibody response, of the immune response, may condition the morphology of the lesions. In 1961, also, for the first time, we were invited, Dr. Siegel and me, to present our work to the annual conference of the nephrotic syndrome in Princeton. And so I presented my work on nephrotoxic nephritis, and Dr. Siegel presented the work done with the immunofluorescence of the human renal biopsy that we were receiving from Italy. And the Then in 62, when I was still struggling with my technique, then there was another important fact for me, and that Dixon came to Columbia to see me, and he came, and Dr. Feldman came a few months later. And I have some picture of the Dr. Dixon who came to see me and discuss the picture of his model with me, and then this is a picture of La Jolla, of the laboratory of Dixon, which was set up by Dixon in La Jolla. And this is a recent picture when Dr. Dixon retired. And I think I have also a picture of Dr. Feldman, which is this one, when he came to see me in 61, and more recently in his house in La Jolla. Then in this meeting, I remember we discussed, we went to play tennis, and then on the Hudson River, we discussed two things with Dr. Dixon. One, that he strengthened my idea that would have been important to study the pathogenesis of the disease, or renal disease. And therefore, we should have not pay great attention to the morphologists, which were practically the monopoly of the meeting, and Dixon was considered a little bit an outcast. And second, he invited me to go to the Scripps Clinic that he was developing as a head of the renal group. And so he said, think about this for 1 year and then give me your answer.
Fernandez, thus from 1964 to 1969, you tried to set up a renal group in Rome using NIH funds. Why did you have such a project? And what were its aims? And finally, were you successful with this project?
Well, the alternative was to remain in the United States or to come back to Italy. My band was to stay in Italy because I had my family, my education, and I am very attached to Italy, and I would have preferred to stay in Italy. At the same time, the study of the pathogenesis of renal disease was making great strides, especially because Dixon, who became chairman of pathology in Pittsburgh when he was 33 years old, and he assembled this extraordinary group of people in Pittsburgh, Barry Pierce, Charlie Corcoran, Joe Feldman, Bob Weigel, and other, I decided to leave the academia and to go to La Jolla, which is a kind of American Portofino, and to build on this peninsula a new center for the study of renal disease, the inflammatory reaction. And Dixon was one of the first in the United States with Pressman to use a radioisotope in the study of the antigen-antibody reaction. And he had clear idea what to do. He especially was a great manager. I think he could have been an extraordinary manager of the General Motors or in any place. And he was assembling an extraordinary group of talented people in this new center at the Scripps Clinic in La Jolla, especially Emil Unanue, who was studying renal disease. And quickly he became, with the application of a radioisotope to the study of the turnover of antibody in experimental glomerulonephritis, what we were used to call the Mr. Kidney. He was an immigrant from Cuba, and he is extremely talented. He became one of the leading immunologists. Now he's the chairman of immunology and pathology at Washington University in St. Louis. But at that time, he was really one of the most advanced young investigators, and many others working with him, with Dixon. So at that time, nephrology was making a great advance in the United States. I'm just talking about my field because I was making progresses also in other fields. And so it was not really the right time to leave and to try to go set up a new group to Italy. But I made this decision, and soon I didn't regret this decision because it was a new challenge, and I went there with new ideas and quickly I was able to recruit very good, talented young people. But to say to recruit, it's a wrong verb, because I didn't recruit anybody. They came, simply because I set up a laboratory, I started to work, and they were coming from every place, and I could not really take all of them. But the one which was possible to accommodate in this small laboratory that we tried to organize according to new idea, and with NIH money, so we were not really bound to the strict rule of the Italian university. It was difficult to pay the bill, etc. We were paying directly. With these extraordinarily good young people who then became my friend for life, I would like to mention all of them, because then my plan was to send them to some laboratory in the United States for 2-3 years to build up different kind of expertise in order to have overlapping experiences in order to build a strong group. Something similar to what Dixon was doing with much larger scale in La Jolla. Or much larger scale, I have to say. But anyway, I had Lilia Cini, who then went to work at Columbia with Dr. Siegel and Dr. Shu, and she became expert in conjugation of antibody, and then became a senior investigator of the Italian National Research Council. Dr. Tognetti, who went to work at Scripps Clinic with Dixon, and Tognetti did a very important work with Dixon and Alston, showing that in autoimmune disease of NZB mice, a viral infection can exacerbate the course of the disease, increasing the production of anti-DNA antibody, etc. And Tognetti is a professor of medicine, a dean of the medical school at the University all'Aquila in Italy. Mario Stefanini, I sent to work in Los Angeles in a department of ultrastructure, and now he's professor of anatomy in the University of Rome. It's one of the best laboratories of Italy, where they are very advanced in the study of stem cells. And Mario is a very good investigator and very good professor. And Carlo Bruni, who was sent to me by Professor Califano, who was the head of Research Council, who is now professor of pathology in Naples. And Cesare De Martino, who was my collaborator, also when I was in the States, that I sent also in Los Angeles, and he was director of the laboratory of electron microscopy in the Iran Institute of Rome, and Pier Giorgio Natali, who is now the scientific director of the Cancer Institute in Rome. And Pier Giorgio went to work at the Scripps Clinic for 3 years, working with Tan, and he did very nice work on the effect of ultraviolet light in the autoimmune response with Dr. Tan. So all these people were of great stimulation, and I learned from them more than what I was able to teach them. So we formed a group that I was very excited and very happy to work with them, and lucky. And I remember that period with great nostalgia.
How came that in the late 1960s you were involved in the study of renal transplantation?
When I was in Rome, at that time I had an appointment of visiting professor at Columbia, so I was spending every year a certain number of months at Columbia. It was during one of this period, and I think during a meeting of the Federation Society in Philadelphia, that I was approached by Dr. Kendrick Porter. Dr. Kendrick Porter was the head of pathology at St. Mary's Hospital in London, and I knew that was considered the leading study of the morphology of human allograft. And so he approached me and told me, look, we have a group, and the leading person is Tom Starzl in Denver, and every year we meet in Denver for a period of 10-15 days in order to collect material, because Dr. Starzl is calling back all his transplant, renal biopsies are taken, sample of blood, and it's all the various people interest, the group of Cepellini, the group from Italy, the group of Amos from the United States, the group of Kendrick Porter from London, meet there and collect all this material, and then we study all this material together. And then after a short while, to the group of Denver, the group of London and the group of Montreal and the group of Toronto, they participate in this joint effort. So I started to go to Denver at the beginning, and then also in other places with my bag, with my old fixative and ingredients, because in this group I was in charge to take the specimen and to divide the part of the specimen obtained by biopsy by surgical biopsy, which was performed by Tom Starzl, for morphology, and they were going to London, and the part for immunofluorescence and immunoferritin, and I was studying the specimen in Rome and not at Columbia, because I had a better laboratory in Rome, especially electron microscopy. I didn't have it at Columbia. So this was the beginning of the study. And these studies were remarkable for the failure. And it's still very painful to remember this failure, because the main issue after some times became the issue of the pathogenesis of hyperacute rejection. You have to consider that allograft rejection, mainly on the basis of skin transplantation, was considered a cell-mediated phenomenon. There was no evidence whatsoever that antibodies were involved. And so there was no evidence. So practically, my work was supposed to provide information in this field. And shortly after the beginning of these studies, because the cross-matching test was not yet performed, Starzl had two or three cases of hyperacute rejection of organs in patients who had received already a previous graft, or that probably had performed antibody. But at that time, we didn't know. Terasaki was starting to know, because he was starting to do his very advanced serology. So I had this tissue, and I found a lot of fibrinogen, but not immunoglobulin. So Starzl was calling and writing at me, Columbia, in Rome, but what happened? I cannot continue to go on with the program, because I need to know what is the pathogenesis of this what he called disaster, because the kidney was practically rejected under his eyes when the abdomen was still open. And they had removed a kidney which was from a living donor. So I was not able to provide information because I had only fibrinogen and no immunoglobulin. So at a certain point, Starzl was probably disappointed about my failure to provide information. So he asked Dixon to help. And so Lerner, at that time I was not still working on kidney, started to collect the same specimen. So we were dividing part of the specimen for me and part for Dick Lerner. And then we had another cases of hyperacute rejection. And again, I found fibrinogen, and also Dick Lerner found fibrinogen. So then quickly, Dixon was very quick. Dr. Siegel was, also because I told you that Columbia was very difficult to publish paper because the paper had to be read and approved by all the members of the department. And we have to cross the Forche Caudine of Elvin Cabot because if you did not show that antibody, the specific for the certain antigen, were present in the lesions, and therefore the lesions were ascribed exactly to that type of antigen-antibody reaction, then it was not possible to publish anything. So I had a close scrutiny at Columbia with Elvin Cabot. So Dixon rapidly published a paper which made a big splash in New England Journal of Medicine that hyperacute rejection was a kind of Schwarzman reaction and that some toxin was responsible for this massive intravascular coagulation and deposition of kidney. So at the same time, D. Milgrom in Buffalo, by using the mixed agglutination technique, was able to show, by working with Williams at Baltimore at John Hopkins, to show that the antibody, that in tissue of kidney tissue, which was rejected, was possible to show that there was binding of antibody, of human antibody, autologous antibody. And this was using this technique with erythrocyte coated with Ripley cells, which were agglutinated by human IgG, the human antibody, which then he had disagglutination of erythrocytes. And then he published in New England Journal of Medicine this first paper that in hyperacute rejection, there were antibody bound to tissue. So then at Columbia there was the paper of Schwartz and Dixon was considered completely wrong, that there was a big mistake, that was not possible, the Schwartz reaction. But really there was not convincing evidence, with the only evidence, serologic evidence, already published in Denmark, by a group of investigators and also by Starzl with Terasaki, that there was a decrease in level of a transplantation antibody, not well-defined antibody, transplantation antibody, after rejection, because the antibody were fixed to tissue and therefore the level was decreased in the circulation. But I remember that then I had a patient who had rejected the kidney but slowly. And then in this kidney I had a lot of immunoglobulin in glomeruli. And I had this picture, but I was not able really, they were precious because it was the first real evidence that in rejection the humoral mechanism were important. But I couldn't publish this because Dr. Cabot and Dr. Siegel said, but you know, you have immunoglobulin, but we have no proof that a real antibody. So one day, John van Rood, who with Dossier discovered the transplantation antibody in Holland, he came to Columbia to give a lecture and then came to visit. And I had my picture on the desk. And he saw this picture, said, but you have immunoglobulin in this kidney, but this is really evident that immunoglobulin participate in acute or peri-acute rejection. So there is evidence of humoral mechanism. And so I had this evidence, but I didn't publish, and so I lost. This was another disappointment. But the disappointment may be combined with some new opening, because I had a visit after Van Rood of a gentleman from Buffalo. It was Felix Milgrom, who was the chairman of microbiology. He had succeeded Dr. Vitebsky, who was the father of autoimmunity, the one with Rose developed the autoimmune thyroiditis. Was the first autoimmune, experimental autoimmune disease. And Dr. Milgrom came, and he was, as I told you, the man who did this paper with the mixed agglutination technique in allograft rejection, came to visit me at Columbia and said, well, it would be very nice if you could join our group. Think about, you should come as a professor, and we will do everything to organize a good group. And at that time, the offer was very attractive, because Buffalo was, La Jolla, the strongest group in immunology, much stronger than Columbia, where there was practically no real tradition of renal study, with the exception of some renal physiology with Dr. Bradley. And there was no real interest in renal transplantation. In contrast, in Buffalo, the group organized, which was built by Dr. Vitebsky, included Dr. Milgrom, who discovered a rheumatoid factor and then was deeply involved in study of transplantation with a group of John Hopkins. There was Dr. Rose, Noel Rose, who was the one who did the work on experimental thyroiditis. There was Tom Tomasi, who was the one who discovered IgA and the first line of defense, the mucosal immune system. There was Maurice Reitlin, who was with Kunkel, the leading expert on DNA, discovering all the antibody to RNA in lupus, etc. There was Allen, who was very strong in the study of the immunology of infectious diseases. So it was a very, very strong group, and I was supposed to build a renal group in Buffalo with the appointment in the Buffalo General Hospital and the university, and with the program of studying especially the pathogenesis of renal diseases and allograft rejection in Buffalo. And so for reason independent of my will related to the situation of the university in Italy and to this offer from the State University of New York, in 1969 I left Italy for good, and with great regret I departed from this my Roman group. And I went to Buffalo.
Professor Andres, when you left Columbia University to move to State University of New York State, did you have the possibility to continue with your studies on the pathogenesis of glomerular diseases?
Yes, we were involved with Dr. Milgrom and his group. Collaborative work in the study of immunologic mechanism of renal diseases. And especially we were interested in the mechanism of formation of immune deposits in membranous glomerulonephritis in the rat, in the model, Heyman model, model of Dr. Heyman. And we did for several years, we studied with various approaches this model sometimes in collaboration with Dr. Farquhar, and we came to the conclusion that this antigen, which is expressed on the plasma membrane of the food process of the podocyte, is shed after interaction with the antibody, is shed between the podocytes and the basement membrane, forming the subepithelial deposits, producing probably an hypersecretory reaction in the podocytes, which give rise to the spikes. So we studied this mechanism, and then in addition, we did several studies on the pathogenetic mechanism of tubule interstitial nephritis, which led to the identification of tubular basement membrane antigen, which may be responsible of some rare cases of autoimmune tubule interstitial nephritis. And then we continue with Dr. Milgrom the study of mechanism of rejection. So we had the possibility to continue, especially with the involvement of several Italian and Japanese investigators. In Japan, the group of nephrology of Nagoya, that was a great pleasure of having in Buffalo.
Professor Andres, a last question. You devoted your professional life to the study of the mechanisms which are involved in the renal diseases. What have been, in your view, the main progresses in the study of the pathogenesis of glomerulonephritis in the last 40 years?
Well, I think that I can talk about my narrow field of interest. And when I started to attend to the meeting of to the annual conferences of the nephrotic syndrome, the real issue was, is the immune response involved in the pathogenesis of renal diseases? And I think today, after this 40 years of 40 year of work, we can categorically state that yes, the answer is yes, the immune response is responsible for many types of renal diseases. In order to achieve this result, it was necessary to take many and different roads, to recognize many mistakes. But I think there is the convincing evidence that immunological response, and also today we know this in details, the various facets of this response, antibody-mediated, cell-mediated, combined, they play a key role. But at the same time, in spite of the awareness of this progress, there are many disappointments because we still, especially in the West world group of nephrology, which are involved in the study of autoimmune mechanism of renal disease, we still don't know which are the antigen involved. And so from this point of view, the most quoted example is membranous glomerulonephritis, that the antigen is still unknown after 50 years of investigation. So from this point of view, there is a certain dissatisfaction. On the other hand, I think that probably more interest should be devolved to various type of nephropathies which occur in third world country, where there are less means for the study of renal diseases. Obviously, in addition to the progress in the understanding the etiology and the pathogenesis of renal disease, the major progresses were in the in the area of renal the hemodialysis and the peritoneal dialysis and renal transplantation. When I started to as a medical student and young physician, renal diseases were not treatable. I still remember when we were trying to apply, to expose our patient with uremia to heat in order to promote the emuntory function of the skin and to produce a release of urea from the skin. There was no other type of treatment which was available. Nowadays, we are able to give a second chance of life to most patients with chronic renal disease. So this progress has been fantastic, and the progress in now with the advancement of modern technique in molecular biology and in the possible use of stem cells will certainly open a new avenue of research for young nephrologists and a new possibility of treatment for our patients.
Thank you very much.